it's hard to understand how Esau could have been so foolish, or how Jacob could have been so conniving. When we pray, deliver us from temptation, or lead us not into temptation, I feel that when Jesus gave his disciples these words, he knew about how Satan tempted people. Right after Jesus was baptized by John the Baptist, he went into the wilderness for 40 days. And during that 40 days, he was tempted by Satan. And when you read that story from the New Testament, you will see that Jesus used Scripture to resist Satan, which is an example for us. We all face temptation. We all have issues, we call them today. I know the things that tempt me. I know when I fall short of being that which God has called me to be. But I know that the Lord is always with me, and that he will give me the desire to not yield to the temptations in my life. Sometimes when this verse of Scripture is read, some people say that God tempts us. I do not think that is the intention. I think we let ourselves be led into temptation. And I want to read some extra verses for you this morning. This scripture comes from James 1, 12 through 16. I was tempted not to mark these scriptures. James 1, verses 12 through 16. Blessed is the man who endures temptation, for when he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he is drawn away by his own desires. Then, when desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin, when it is full grown, brings forth death. So who leads us into temptation? Ourselves. So many times when we are trying our best to change a habit that is causing us harm, we are so easily tempted by what drew us to that in the beginning. But the Holy Spirit is always available to assist us and to help us. Our problem comes, I think, when we think that we ourselves can handle that temptation. I thought of lots of temptations, but I felt like we all know our own. I think about the person who buys lottery tickets at the convenience store on a daily basis. To me, that seems so foolish. But to that person, evidently, it brings some kind of excitement, followed by great disappointment when that person does not win. How can they not set themselves up for that temptation by not going to the convenience store that sells lottery tickets? Or go to a different store where that's not your habit, or that's not common for you? It is our responsibility to take ourselves out of situations that tempt us. John Wesley said that when it came to the consumption of alcohol, that he felt that there was not a sin in consuming alcohol, but the sin came when alcohol was your addiction. And because of up close and personal times that I have seen people who were alcoholic and how that affected their family and their community and their own life, I always thought, you know, when they first started drinking, they didn't start out to be an alcoholic. So avoid those things that will bring you destruction. John Wesley said that he chose not to drink alcohol because it might cause his brother to stumble. There are stumbling blocks put in our way each and every day. And how we respond to those blocks is how we follow the Lord. In the story about Jacob and Esau, it's so hard to realize that his own brother tricked him. His own brother put a stumbling block in front of him. When I was 5 years old, which we all know was quite some time ago, this happened. And I have always remembered it because it made such an impact on my life. My sister and I, she was 13 months older than me. And if she told me to do something, Joe, I did. Because she always watched out for me. She always took care of me, if you will. She always led me in the right direction. But this one time, I think I was 5 and she was 6. And we went to the little store in our community. And as we went into the store, she said to me, pick up that box of crayons and put them in your pocket. I honestly think that I was young enough that I didn't quite see the reality of that temptation. So I did exactly what she said. And then we ran out to the car and hid the crayons in the glove compartment. The owner of the store then proceeded outside with our father. My father was 6'3", and he was a big presence. And so when he got out to the car with the owner of the convenience store, my daddy was saying, "My girls wouldn't do that. My girls did not do that. There is no way my girls did that." But when the man asked us to produce the crayons, since we were new at being a thief, we handed them over. And so I still to this day remember the disappointed look on my dad's face. Dad paid for the crayons and we went home. I think he talked about that for at least 2 to 3 hours. And I still remember him saying to my mother, "Do you think we should call the preacher and have him come talk to them?" Well, I knew then I must have done something really, really bad because the preacher didn't usually talk to me up close and personal. But I knew right away after my dad talked to us that what we had done was wrong. And that my sister had put a stumbling block in my way. And I wanted to say, "I just did what she told me to do." My dad did not accept that as a logical explanation for my transgression. I want you to know that I have never stolen another box of crayons in my entire life. And my sister and I talk about this story and what an impact it had on our lives. Because the consequences of our actions were quite severe. And so, as we used those crayons that day, there was no joy. There was no excitement. There was no artistic gifts. For our sin weighed heavy on our hearts. So be aware of those people who put stumbling blocks in your way. Therefore, there may be people you need to avoid. There may be people that you don't need to associate with. Someday, I will tell you all about my younger brother, Will. Will started out with alcohol and marijuana. And for 15 years of his life, he was addicted to these substances. Because of this addiction, he had great difficulty in life. His marriage did not last. He lost material things. He had to spend 5 years in a facility that they don't let you go and come as you please. But praise God, in that facility, he humbled himself, he asked for forgiveness, and he wanted Jesus Christ to live in his heart and create within him a new creature. And that happened. And so, when my brother was 35, I had a new brother who was a new creature. And what a joy and a thrill that was. When he returned home from the facility, all of his old friends began to come by. And he witnessed to each of them. Some of them accepted Jesus Christ, and some of them never came back. I am so thankful for what God did in his life. But you know, when he first tried marijuana, he wasn't intending to become an addict, nor did he intend to pay the consequences. So it's those little temptations that we have to be on guard about. First Peter 5:18. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about life like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Resist him, steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood in the world. But may the God of all grace, who called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a while, perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. To him be the glory and the dominion forever and ever. The scripture in the New Testament tells us over and over again that evil is a reality in our world. And none of us have trouble believing that because we watch the news on a regular basis. And we all know that our world is in need of Jesus Christ. And we all know that we are the witnesses. And I think one temptation that really takes us is when we have an opportunity to share Jesus Christ. It's not what we did, it's what we didn't do. And so, ask the Lord to give you opportunities to share your faith, and he will. And I like being new in town, because you meet new people. And so, when I meet new people, I'm an outgoing person, so I chit-chat. We just moved here. We've been here 6 weeks. What is the next question? Well, where did you move from? Nobody's heard of hell, but that's what I say, because that's where we came from. And then they ask the next question, after I say we love it here, the next question is, well, why did you move? And then I get to say, I'm the new pastor at Providence United Methodist Church. And if you don't have a church, we'd love to have you come and worship with us. And sometimes they say, well, I go to, and they tell me. And sometimes there's a look on their face that says, you know what? I might just do that. But you know, my responsibility is to invite them. It is my responsibility to share Jesus Christ with them. It is my responsibility to give God the glory for what he's done in my life. Amen?
Amen.
If God ain't done nothing in your life, it's your fault. If God has not done anything in your life, it is your fault. Because you have not opened up your heart and your life to him. You are allowing temptation to keep you from having and receiving that which God has for you. Do not be a stumbling block to your brothers and sisters in Christ. A lot happened in my life when I was 5 years old, and I'm just amazed that I can remember it. But there are things that happen that really speak to our hearts. A lesson that we learn that stays with us for life. I think I mentioned before that my cousin Jackie and I were the same age, and we were always inseparable. And I just always loved getting to be at Jackie's house, and I always loved when Jackie got to be at my house. And even though we are 60 years older now, we still always love that time that we get to spend together. But when I was 5 years old, we had gone to Aunt Elsie's and Uncle Rayford's. And Jackie and I were playing outside on the swing set. And we loved the swing. It was so much fun. And we would do the seesaw and we'd go back and forth. And it was just a child's delight. Well, I said to Jackie one day, why don't we walk down the road? And Jackie said, my daddy said I wasn't to do that. And the stumbling block person said, he won't know. I might have been outgoing, but I wasn't too smart. So she said, no, my daddy told me not to do that. And I said, let's try it. Let's walk down the road. We went walking down the road. And Uncle Rayford saw us, and he came and got us. Uncle Rayford was a strict person. Sometimes I thought he was a little on the hateful side. But right then and there, he said to my favorite cousin Jackie, I told you not to walk in the road. And I kept saying it was my fault. I was the one that wanted to do this. And Uncle Rayford ignored me completely. And he said, but you knew better. And then he spanked her. It was the worst spanking of my life because I didn't get a spanking. And I kept saying, Uncle Rayford, it was my fault. And he kept saying that she knew better. And he looked at me and he said, I ought to spank you too. And I said, yes. And I guess he didn't think my daddy would appreciate that. So he didn't. But I remembered that all my life. And several times I've mentioned that story to my cousin. Oh, she remembers it too. And I'm serious when I say I truly felt guilty that I had been a stumbling block and I had led her down the path. But she told me recently a most awesome aspect of this story. She said, you need to let go of your concern. Because you see, I learned a valuable lesson. I never let anybody else talk me into doing something that I knew I shouldn't do. And I thought, praise the Lord, I can be forgiven for my sin. It's a simple story, but it has a profound meaning. If someone is a stumbling block in your life, then you need to back off, move away, not listen. Our temptations come in many forms. We are all tempted, as I said. We remember the story of Peter and how he denied even knowing Jesus. He was asked three times, and for three times he said he did not know Jesus. We cannot be too judgmental on Peter, because we have all fallen short. But Peter, when he met the risen Savior, asked for forgiveness, and forgiveness was given. Scripture was a great leader, and he did his best to set an example. and he set an example by how he lived. And the way we live sets an example for others. I've got one last little comment. Timothy Moore was a minister at my home church probably 20 years ago. He was a young man then. But anyway, he was very effective. And I lived away, but when I was home, I would visit. And I noticed that each time I visited that the congregation had increased. And I looked around, and there were people that had lived in our community all their lives that had never attended. And I thought, well, I wonder what he is doing. Because, you know, he didn't know who didn't attend, because he was new. And so, because I was entering the ministry, I talked to him and I said, what did you do? How did this happen? And he said, prayer. And then he said, people do what they see done by the minister. And if the minister is out visiting, if the minister is seeking to find ways to share the good news of Jesus Christ, if the minister is listening to the voice of the Lord, then the congregation will do that also. I have tried to always remember that. Always. For we are not a pastor and a congregation. We are followers of Jesus Christ. This is the verse that I mentioned that I need you to know by memory, and it's Philippians 4:18. I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. And how many of us have said that verse over and over again when things were very difficult? I can do all things through Christ that strengthens me. So when we are faced with temptation, let us quote that scripture. When we are faced with temptation, let us seek forgiveness. And we know that when we ask, our Heavenly Father forgives us and gives us the strength to stand firm when we are trying to be led astray, either by evil or by others. Our closing hymn.